Saludos, Vida Abundante. Habla Jonathan Gallardo y aquí estamos en TEDS, Trinity Evangelical Divinity School. Y estamos súper emocionados porque durante estas semanas estaremos entrevistando a varios de los profesores aquí de la historia de la iglesia. Y ellos nos van a ayudar a entender en por qué la reforma tuvo que suceder. Entonces, esté atento a todo lo que vamos a estar poniendo en Facebook y en todas nuestras redes sociales porque va a ser muy interesante preparándonos para nuestra serie en octubre, La Reforma Protestante 500 años. Te esperamos. Saludos amigos de Vida Abundante, otra vez mi nombre es Jonathan Gallardo y aquí estamos con el Dr. Doug Sweeney, aquí un profesor de Church History, de Historia de la Iglesia, aquí en el Instituto y el Seminario TEDS. Él nos va a estar respondiendo algunas preguntas acerca de la Reforma y su efecto en el siglo XIX. Dr. Doug Sweeney, thank you for meeting with us today.
It's great to be with you, thank you, Jonathan.
Yes, we were discussing a little bit was about the effects of the Reformation, especially in the 18th century and in the preaching of Jonathan Edwards in the First Great Awakening. What were some of those effects, or what was some of the legacy the Reformation had during that period?
Yeah, a lot of effect. It seems to me we could summarize it in three main ways. First way, the Reformation put such a strong emphasis on getting the Bible in the hands of the people and helping them learn to read it and understand it. And that had such an important, powerful role in Western history in the 1600s and 1700s that by the time you get to Jonathan Edwards and his ministry in Puritan New England, the Bible really was in the center of the whole culture. When the Puritans immigrated from England to New England and were finally able to build up communities in the way that they wanted to build them up without getting in trouble for it, they put the Bible in the middle of everything they did. In fact, they called their towns Bible Commonwealths to symbolize how central a role they wanted the Bible to play in people's lives. And they passed laws. The most famous of these was called the Old Deluder Satan Law that was passed in Massachusetts in 1647. And that law started out by saying, the main thing Satan wants to do in our towns is keep the Bible away from people. So our law stipulates that whenever our town or any New England town gets to be 50 families or larger, you have to hire a reading teacher. And the purpose of hiring the reading teacher was they wanted the reading teacher to teach the kids how to read the Bible. And then as soon as your town gets to be 100 families or larger, you have to build a building as a school for the kids to learn how to read, mainly by learning how to read the Bible in the school. The church was built usually in the center of these towns. The Bible was just physically in the center of the church building. And they all agreed the most important thing the pastor does is help people to understand the Bible, the Word of God. So that's a super important legacy of the Protestant Reformation by the time of the 1700s when Jonathan Edwards was around and the Great Awakening took place. A second really important thing that happened that was a result of the Reformation was that by Edwards' day, people in his world really believed that the Bible is a divine book. It's the Word of God, and it has power in it to save us from our sins and show us how to live. And especially the gospel message has that power. So you may have talked in your church already about how Martin Luther experienced his Reformation breakthrough when he was meditating on Romans chapter 1, verses 16 and 17. Where the Apostle Paul says, "For I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for the gospel is the power of God for the salvation of all who believe, first the Jew and the Gentile. It reveals a righteousness from God that is by faith from first to last, for as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith." Well, by Edward's time, people in New England took this for granted. They took this truth for granted. They took the idea that the Bible has a they called it an inherent power, a power inside it because it's God's Word to convict us of our sin, to save us from our sin, and especially the gospel message has this power. So the reason why we had this major period of revival we call the Great Awakening was because these guys got so excited about preaching this powerful gospel message and spreading it as wide as they could. So in the time of the Great Awakening, thousands and thousands of people became Christian and devoted themselves to Christ in a very personal way because of this message. Then the third thing I think that's an effect of the Reformation, I'd want to say, is also kind of an advance on what took place during the time of the Reformation. The time of the Reformation was the time in Europe that we call Christendom, where everybody was officially Christian. If you lived in Catholic territory, you were officially Catholic. If you lived in Protestant territory, you were officially Protestant. And some Protestant territory was called Lutheran territory, some was called Reformed territory. In England, they had Church of England territory. And more often than not, the way people thought you spread Christianity is by spreading Christian territory, by colonizing other countries. And we in the Western Hemisphere know all about colonization. But during the Great Awakening, because of this Reformation belief in the inherent power of the Bible and the gospel especially to save, people pioneered this whole new way of spreading Christianity, which was by grassroots evangelization, sharing the gospel, sharing the Bible with people, not taking over their country and making it officially Christian in the name of a European king, but spreading the gospel message and putting the Bible in the hands of the people. And the reason why we have this modern missions movement and what we call the modern evangelical movement that comes out of the modern missions movement is because of that belief in the power of the Bible and the gospel.
So it was recovering that call that the Reformers originally had of sola scriptura, the power of the Word of God.
Exactly. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sweeney, for your time and for spending this time with us.
Y como escucharon, eso fue el Dr. Doug Sweeney. Hay mucho más que él nos puede enseñar acerca de eso, pero creo que pudimos entender la suficiencia de la escritura en el siglo XVIII. Te esperamos la próxima semana con el episodio 3.